today's specific topic, the science underlying Gandhi's methods. I intend to share with you both my views as well as experiences. Let's start with the editorial office of the Time magazine in New York. It is December of the year 1999. At the end of the 20th century, and the Time magazine wants to select the person of the 20th century. Large number of names are suggested, and popular choice boils down to two names: Albert Einstein and Mahatma Gandhi. The editors have a dilemma. And finally, editors select Einstein as the person of the 20th century. Science and the scientist triumphed over Gandhi, but in popularity. That was the judgment in the 20th century. Now, today in the 21st century, we need to re-examine the relationship between science and Gandhi once again and come to our own judgment. That's what I'm going to attempt to do in this lecture with you. I'm not at all going to talk about the work that I do or I did, because this particular topic is even more fascinating than talking about my own work. I have framed 6 questions for discussing. These questions are, you can read it yourself. So we will start with the allegation against Gandhi that he was anti-science, explore his relationship with the science, but more in depth explore what were his methods. And finally, how is it relevant to us today, if at all? I must begin with a confession. And that confession is that I was born in a Gandhian family. I grew up in Mahatma Gandhi's ashram. I studied in the very school that he himself had started. And then later on, at the age of 18, I started studying medicine, public health, and for the past 35 years, I am doing primarily public health research. For nearly 50 years since I was introduced to science, I have had a checkered relationship with Mahatma Gandhi on the question of science. I have felt embarrassed by his views. I have felt confused. I have felt angry. I have had series of mentally arguments, several arguments with him about the issues of science. I have had disagreements with him, and I am happy to tell you that every time, finally, I have lost and he has won. I propose today to share with you this 50-year struggle with Gandhi and journey to explore Gandhi and science. I also must acknowledge that I will heavily draw upon not only what Mahatma Gandhi has written, but from his life. Several biographers have written beautifully. His foremost disciple and exponent of his thoughts, Vinoba Bhave. One beautiful article which Shambhu Prasad wrote in Economic Political Weekly nearly 20 years ago, and my own experiences and experiments in life. So the first question, was Gandhi anti-science? Jawaharlal Nehru, Rabindranath Tagore, people who were so close to him, and even people in the West like Aldous Huxley, they have accused Gandhi to be anti-science. The architect of India's national science policy, Dr. Meghnad Saha. Look, what does he say about Gandhi? And especially the last part of his sentence is definitely he's hinting at Mahatma Gandhi and his techniques like spinning wheel and the loincloth and the bullock cart. So Meghnad Saha and Jawaharlal Nehru and India as a whole, the intellectual class of India as a whole, believe that Gandhi was anti-science and so largely irrelevant today. Now, Mahatma Gandhi himself was responsible partly for this impression. Hind Swarajya, his probably most seminal book next to his autobiography, he severely criticizes what we consider science, but he is criticizing not science, but he criticizes machines, medical practice. So he appears to be anti-science. And then his faith in the prayers, and finally, ultimately, the Ram Naam. And so for any person of science, for any person who considers himself to be an intellectual, Gandhi is an antithesis. And so we have conveniently labeled him to be an anti-science person. But then look at what he has to say about the scientists. And he says, I have nothing but praise for the zeal and the industry that has animated modern scientists in the pursuit after truth. He very much appreciated scientific spirit, scientific inquiry, and look at his life as the real evidence. And he has himself said that my life is my message. So we must go beyond his books, because beyond his statements, and look at how he lived, what he actually lived. And if we go into that, we find a lifelong curiosity and inquiry about various issues of science, about health sciences, about diet, about sanitation, about germs, about exercise. He wants to know about the chemical analysis of various kinds of foods. His photograph with the microscope is well known. And in that photograph, actually, he's for the first time seeing the lepra bacilli as causative organism of leprosy. When he was in Yerwada jail, after 1942, he took fascination to the telescope. And he developed the hobby of watching in the sky through the telescope. Gandhi liberally used scientific tools and scientific methods. But the most sensitive and difficult part is the attitude. And if we carefully look at Gandhi's attitude, his willingness to test, to experiment, and to look for evidence. These are the attributes of scientist. His willingness to correct himself and change. That statement is very famous, that if a reader finds that my two statements contradict, take the latter one as my better judgment. The political leaders, saints, usually don't admit that my earlier statement was wrong and my newer statement is my new judgment. They take pride in never changing. Gandhi, in this respect, is very much like a scientist. I change my views as the evidence comes. John Maynard Keynes, the famous economist, was once confronted by a politician as to you said something earlier which was different. So the Keynes says that, yes, sir, If the facts change, I change my opinion. What else do you do? So in that respect, Gandhi is very much like a scientist. But the most powerful evidence comes from the episode in Chauri Chaura. We recently celebrated 100 years that event in Chauri Chaura, but we celebrated, government celebrated it for the wrong reasons. But Gandhi had launched National Non-Cooperation Movement in 1920 with the faith that India was ready for a non-violent national movement. But in 1921, a mob in Uttar Pradesh burned down a police station in Chauri Chaura and killed 22 police. Gandhi was shocked. He said, and publicly said, that I made a Himalayan blunder. My judgment, my hypothesis that Indian people were ready for non-violent movement was wrong. It is refuted. I accept it. And so if my hypothesis is wrong, I withdraw the whole national movement. It was probably one of the riskiest moments in Mahatma Gandhi's life. He was just established as a national leader in India, and now he's risking taking back a national movement against the opinion of the entire country. These are signs, these are attributes of a scientist. And his laboratory was himself. Not only the nation was his laboratory, but he himself also was his laboratory. His experiments with Brahmacharya are very famous as well as infamous. But then, he's experimenting on himself. Is there any trace of sexual feeling left in me which I want to get rid of? If I am truly non-violent, if I am truly a saint or so-called Mahatma, I should be completely free from the sexual desires, from vasana. Is it still left in me? So he's doing a most sensitive, risky experiment on himself to search in the recesses of his mind and his body. I know Gandhi has been often very severely misunderstood and criticized for this experiment, but when I read about it, there is a name in medical science called John Hunter. John Hunter was a famous anatomist, maybe 200 years ago. But he did one experiment on himself. To establish how is syphilis transmitted, he took an inoculum from the sore of a patient of syphilis, injected on his own penis, and within few weeks, the ulcer developed. And so he established that this is how the sexually transmitted disease syphilis spreads. Gandhi's experiment on himself is as bold, as adventurous, and as risky as John Hunter's experiments. And it is no wonder that finally Gandhi named his autobiography as My Experiments with Truth. His ultimate goal was to understand the truth. So these are all attributes of a true scientist. He was a scientist of life. So we come to next question. If Gandhi was not anti-science, how did he relate with science? We can see the evidence of Gandhi's relationship with science, his application of science in what Gandhi called his constructive programs. Various programs of rural development, social reforms, these he called constructive programs. And foremost in amongst the constructive programs were Khadi and Charkha. Gandhi repeatedly uses scientific methods. He looks for better and better scientific and technical methods to improve Khadi. so that the ordinary village spinner and weaver can produce better cloth, can get better wages, and people can use more khadi. He even coins the term called khadi science. He calls charkha, the spinning wheel, as a grand and noble machine. It is difficult to believe today, but in about 80 years ago, Gandhi announced an award of rupees 1 lakh in that time, now maybe about 10 crore rupees. He announced that award for somebody to innovate charkha further and make it more efficient. So Gandhi uses science liberally, and he expects from his khadi workers an attitude of a scientist. Look what he says. He's expecting his khadi workers in their concentration, in the refinement, to be similar to Sir Jagdish Chandra Bose and his inquiry with the plants. And also he says that in his view, in his scheme of things, there would be better libraries, more laboratories, research institutes. We'll have chemists and engineers and other experts who will be the real servants of the nation. And now the most important centers. What for all this research infrastructure? He says that they will be the real servants of the nation and answer the varied and growing requirements of a people. The knowledge gained by them will be the common property of the people. Very different than the intellectual property right and patents. Very different that the knowledge is owned by the scientist. Gandhi's purpose of science, purpose of research, and ownership of this knowledge and research is different. He wanted his ashrams, and he uses this terminology. He says his ashram should become laboratories, laboratories of village and social reconstruction. He established what is called All India Village Industries Association for Gramodyog, for encouraging Gramodyog. And on its advisory board, three names would be very familiar to you: Sir C.V. Raman, Jagdish Chandra Bose, and P.C. Ray. The best scientist of India of that time, he invited them to work on his Village Industries Advisory Board. And finally, he coined a term which is so meaningful. The term is Satyagrahi scientist. His model, constructive worker or freedom movement worker or political worker or ashram worker, he says, how should be my worker? He should be Satyagrahi scientist, his ideal worker. He should be Satyagrahi, non-violent, seeker of truth. He should also be a scientist in his attitude, in his methods, in his experimentation. So Satyagrahi scientist, that is the ideal worker of Mahatma Gandhi's vision, and he selected as his first Satyagrahi for the Vyaktigat Satyagrahi in 1940. He didn't select Jawaharlal Nehru as the first Satyagrahi of the nation. Jawahar came next. His first choice was Vinoba Bhave, an obscure person at that time. But he selected Vinoba not only for his spiritual quality, but also for his scientific attitude. Vinoba had done phenomenal work on khadi and charkha. And I must share, because this particular instance speaks so much. It speaks volumes of Gandhi and his followers. When the laborers in khadi, they complained to Mahatma Gandhi that the wages were very meager. And that was natural, because Khadi didn't mass produce, it was not machine manufacturing, so rate of production was slow and the prices had to be kept down so that everybody would be able to purchase, so wages were low. But when they complained, Mahatma Gandhi said, no, we can't do unfairness to the laborer. So he invited Vinoba and asked him to decide minimum wages for the laborers in Khadi. Vinoba asked for some time. After 6 months, he returned. A thinned person, had lost 30 pounds of weight. Gandhi asked him, what happened, Vinoba? And Vinoba says that for the past 6 months, I am doing only occupation of spinning myself. And at the rate of the wages that we give to the Khadi worker, I am able to earn 2 annas per day. And I am eating food only of those 2 annas. Look, with the current wages of Khadi worker, this is what happens to you. Vinoba turned himself into a laboratory. To sum up, Gandhi liberally and enthusiastically welcomed and employed science, scientific methods, and scientists in his constructive work. And his constructive work was very important for him. He has said that the ultimate perfection of constructive work is Swaraj. So if Gandhi was not anti-science, if Gandhi liberally used science in his work, he had very scientific attitude, then how was he different than a scientist? How was he different than us? Make no mistake. Gandhi was not great because he was scientific or because he used science. All of us do that. That doesn't make us Gandhi. Using science is commonplace. So that is not his greatness. He was different in several other ways. His yardstick to evaluate was the purpose the science was used for. Science had to have a meaningful purpose. Look what he says here. He praises the scientist and scientific spirit, but he complains that they are using their skill, their knowledge, their work only for a narrow sense, merely material advancement of its clientele. So for him, this was too narrow a purpose, too shallow a purpose. Science often becomes a tool in the hands of those with the capital or in the hands of government. In the hands of government, it becomes a tool of coercion, of defense and destruction. In the hands of capitalists, it becomes a tool of profit making. So ultimately, most often, science and scientists end up making either capitalist or government more powerful. Power to the capitalist or power to the government. In Gandhi's hands, science becomes a tool for social change and justice. This is what he expects. Unless all the discoveries, ultimately the welfare of the poor, that should be the end view. And look, Gandhi uses no mild words. He says, unless you do that, all your workshops will be really no better than the Satan's workshop. Ah. He shakes us, he badly hits us, forces us to examine as to for what purposes our science, our laboratories, our scientific careers are being used. And Gandhi was great in that sense that he could turn in his hands. Science became a tool of social change and justice. Let's take example of sanitation, cleaning toilets. Now imagine when Gandhi came to India, 1914, no person of higher class or higher varna ever even looked at his toilet. That was the dirtiest place in his house to be cleaned by the so-called dirtiest people in the society. Gandhi applied science to cleaning toilets. He achieved sanitation. He achieved health. He probably must be the first political leader to start cleaning his own toilets, made a public movement of it. Even Jawaharlal Nehru and Rajendra Prasad and Vallabhbhai Patel, when they went to his ashram, they had to clean their own toilets. But in Gandhi's movement, even Brahmins in Maharashtra like Bhave and Bapat and Patwardhan, they started cleaning toilets, not only of their own, but others. This Appa Patwardhan, one gold medalist graduate Brahmin from Maharashtra, he joined Gandhi's movement. In freedom movement, he was jailed. Now, British did not give him toilet cleaning work because he was a Brahmin. And in the jail's rule book, Brahmins couldn't be given this kind of menial work. But Appa Patwardhan says, I am Gandhi's soldier. And it is my life, one of the vows in life, that I'll clean my own toilet. So you ought to give me a bhangi's work. British government refused, so he went on the fast. A Brahmin going on fast, asking to do a bhangi's work, finally the British government had to relent. So Gandhi, through his work of cleaning toilets and sanitation, not only achieved Swachh Bharat sanitation, but he also transcended the Varna barriers. This is what used to happen in Gandhi's hands. He applied moral test to science, and then he criticizes the European science, at that time European, today we might say American science, that advance of science, not an inch to the moral stature of Europe, not added. It has not reduced hatred and injustice. This is what Gandhi expects from science. To reduce hatred, to reduce injustice, and to increase the moral stature of the population. And his complaint is that science doesn't do it. Gandhi applies a moral test to science. And in his eyes, even at least at that time, the science and the scientists failed in that. Let's take case of vivisection, the dissection of living animals. Now, for the sake of knowledge of anatomy or zoology or blood circulation, it was considered that it was very necessary. Gandhi, during his adolescent age, wanted to become a doctor. But one reason why he didn't go for that career was that you had to do vivisection. And his heart revolted against it. Now, Gandhi opposes vivisection even for the sake of gaining knowledge of the inside of the animals, for two reasons: the effect on the animals that it has, pain, suffering, and death. But further, effect on the scientist that the vivisection has. A scientist performing a cruel act of dissecting and killing a living animal, maybe frogs, maybe rabbits, maybe monkeys, maybe guinea pigs. But it's not very, very many steps away from the cruelty and killing of the human beings. So Gandhi didn't support vivisection, or rather actively opposed it, because of its cruel, encouraging cruelty in the human heart, heart of the scientist. Today, cruelty against animal has become a global movement. But imagine 100 years ago, people like Nehru and people of science laughed at Gandhi. He's an anti-science man, doesn't want to dissect. Gandhi was not against dissection of the dead bodies, but he was against dissection of the living animals. Science could not be devoid of morality. One more difference of between we people, the people of science and Gandhi, was that science by its very nature is usually necessarily reductionist. It focuses on one minute, a small part of reality and wants to study in depth. What happens? I saw a beautiful cartoon. A scientist is sitting in the gallery and a comet is expected to rise somewhere in the sky. So he's focusing his telescope on that particular angle, expecting to see the comet when it rises. He's waiting and waiting for days together, but can't see. He's seeing a very, very, through a very narrow angle through the telescope. And his housemaid comes there with tea, and she looks at the sky and she looks at somewhere else and says, "Oh, comet." What the scientist misses because he's focused very narrowly. The housemaid, she might be illiterate, but she's open. She's open to the sky and she can see the comet rising somewhere else. So Gandhi sees the whole picture. He sees the whole truth. He doesn't see only narrow truth, and he doesn't have a fragmented, disintegrated view of the life. He looks at life as an integrated whole thing. And so Khadi, which he is promoting, Khadi would give market to the cotton of the farmer, would give wages to the spinner and the weaver, will encourage Swadeshi movement, will encourage freedom movement, will bring the upper class people closer to the poor class people. Gandhi has an integrated, holistic view, and he achieves multiple things. And finally, one more difference between Gandhi and we people of science is, for Gandhi, nothing is jad, nothing is material, nothing is only material, nothing is dead. There's one very beautiful instance. Mahatma Gandhi had gone to Allahabad and Jawaharlal Nehru had invited him for dinner. After completing the food, Jawaharlal himself was pouring water on Gandhi's hands and Gandhi was cleaning his hands. And while they were also chatting about national things. So while Gandhi has completed his hand washing, Jawaharlal continues to pour water because he is looking at Gandhi's face and not looking at the water. So Mahatmaji says, "Jawahar, you are wasting water." Jawaharlal mockingly says, "Bapu, this is Allahabad. Ganga and Yamuna flow here. So there is no dearth of water. Why do you worry about water?" And Gandhi says, "Jawahar, haan, Ganga aur Yamuna to behti hain Allahabad mein, lekin Ganga aur Yamuna tumhare liye nahi behti hai. You have no right to waste a drop of water just because it is material. Everything here is sacred. Ishavasyam idam sarvam. Everything is permeated with the divine, with the truth principle." So for Gandhi, this view is different than our view. We look at everything as jada, as only material. Gandhi looks at everything as material plus sacred and divine. So Gandhi's uniqueness, greatness is located outside of the science. He is located in his moral dimension. He summarized this moral dimension in two words: truth and non-violence. Shambhu Prasad very beautifully says that though a great believer in science, he was clear of his role in the cosmos, in this universe. Science to him was not above truth and ahimsa, truth and non-violence. Truth and non-violence were truer than many so-called scientific facts. If it is so, instead of only appreciating Gandhi for his science, but he was Gandhi's uniqueness is not in science, but it is in truth and non-violence. Let's try to understand what is the science of his non-violence and science of truth. Now, science underlying truth scientist and Gandhi have a common goal, that is, they are the seekers of truth. And for Gandhi, truth is the ultimate goal of life. To the extent that an atheist like him, earlier he used to say that truth is next to God. Then he started saying that truth is like God. And finally, in his final years, what Gandhi used to say, truth is God. A statement. A religious and person of faith saying this, there is no other God. Truth is God. So that is Gandhi's view about truth. For exploring material facts, Gandhi used the common scientific instruments. He used microscope and telescope also. But for knowing the moral and or spiritual truth, Gandhi had some other method. What was that method? He hinted about this method to the students of Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore when he talked to them in 1929. And look what he tells them. He's talking about an instrument for internal research. And all research will be useless if it is not allied to this internal research. So he has some other instrument to do this internal research. He believed in one discussion with Rajgopalachari, he pointed out that he treated his mother, who was so well versed in the art of fasting, he treated her as a scientist. Why? One who is pure, who adheres to truth and wants to cling to it, is as much a scientist as a physicist. Physicist is, of course, the most pure scientist. But then Gandhi is saying that my mother was closer to that because she was pure. She fasted, she purified herself. Gandhi's method to know the moral truth, to spiritual truth, was purify yourself. He had his Ekadash Vrata, 11 vows of 11 rules of conduct, 11 vratas. But these are all for purifying your conduct and purifying your heart and your life. And then he uses fasting as a method to purify himself, purify his heart, and then ultimately prayer, that my efforts have limit. I can't myself, I can't go any further. So finally, I submit, I pray, and the symbol of the truth, Ramana. When you make yourself zero, your ego becomes zero, when your heart is clean, when your life is clean, as Gandhi tried to make himself, in that clean state of heart, what appears in that mirror of your heart is the reflection of moral truth. Gandhi called this as inner voice. When he took that decision of withdrawing national movement because of Chauri Chaura episode, he says that my inner voice tells me that you were wrong. And the whole world may go against me, but I'll follow my inner voice. This inner voice, almost one can say as if message of the God or voice of the conscience. Gandhi connected with that through a particular method. It was not an accident. He had a method. Your speech must be purified. It should be truthful. Your behavior should be non-violent. You should follow brahmacharya, sanyam, shariishram, prayer, fasting, and ultimately submitting to God's will. And when you make your ego zero in that clean heart, you get the vision of truth. To us, this is opaque. We don't understand. We know only material methods of measurement. And we don't want to take efforts to clean our hearts. Who would bother? We'll clean our body, but not our hearts, not our conduct. And so we, the intellectuals and the scientists, conveniently labeled him as superstitious, one who talks of such mystical things as inner voice. Because we don't have inner voice, we said nobody can have it. But Gandhi accessed moral truth, spiritual truth, through this kind of processes. He has also often said that non-violence is the means to know the truth, to reach the truth. So if it was so, what was the science underlying non-violence? We all know Gandhi for his non-violence, for his satyagraha. His non-violence was very effective against the British in South Africa, against the British in India, against the communal riots in Calcutta. What a complete company of army couldn't do, this one single frail man, old man could do. He was followed by Martin Luther King, which ultimately resulted into a black man, Obama, becoming the president of the US. Nelson Mandela followed it. And finally won the freedom for South Africa. They all followed Mahatma Gandhi's method of non-violence. When I went to see Robben Island near Cape Town, it is in the sea, where Nelson Mandela was kept in prison for 27 years by the white people in the South Africa. Imagine the anger, the hatred, which Nelson Mandela should have accumulated against the white people. But fortunately for me, when I went to see that jail where he was kept, my guide was actually the person who had lived. He was the prison inmate of Nelson Mandela. So out of curiosity, I asked him, what was special about Nelson Mandela's personality? And that guide, he was a black young boy, not young at that time actually, maybe in his 40s. But that black man told me that Nelson liberated me of the hatred for the white people. This man, my guide, was also in prison. He was seething with anger against the white people. And he says that Nelson liberated me of that hatred for the white people. This is what nonviolence did. In that film, Attenborough's film Gandhi, that very difficult to forget scene of the Satyagraha movement in Dharasana, in Salt Satyagraha, and how British soldiers are beating Satyagrahi men and women with the blunt instrument. Thud, thud, thud. Blood is flowing. Skulls are cracking. But Satyagrahis don't resist. They don't raise their hand. They can, but they don't. And finally, it does produce effect. And when the Jesus Christ said that if someone slaps you on one cheek, turn your another cheek to him. So why is nonviolence effective? It's not imaginary thing. We have seen several instances how nonviolence does become effective, but why? There exists love and tenderness in everybody's heart. It's a universal law of nature. Jim Corbett, the famous hunter, describes one episode in his jungle stories. He says once he was passing through jungle and he hears bleating of a lamb. And he also sees a tigress lurching, which jump on that lamb. That lamb is lost in the forest, a tiny tender. And this tigress is now looking at it as a prey. She's lurching. So Jim Corbett aims his gun at the tigress, but waits. Tigress is crouched. She moves a little further and suddenly stands up. Starts walking to that lamb. Then starts licking the lamb. She plays with the lamb for a while. Then vanishes in the jungle without harming the lamb. Amazing. And many of you might have seen either on the Discovery or Animal Planet similar episodes. Now, the cruelest animals also have that tender feeling and love towards a lamb. Nonviolence generates that tender feeling, that love. And it banks on this. What happens in the violence, opposite of nonviolence? Somebody hits you and a hit elicits anger and you hit back. So a hit elicits a reaction. That's why Gandhi said that the law of violence is that an eye for an eye and soon the whole world is blind. So violence generates equal and opposite violence. And actually, violence follows the Newton's third law of mechanics. For every action, there is equal and opposite reaction. We know that law. Newton's law applied to human psychology. Violence begets violence. Anger begets anger. Strong words beget strong words. Equal and opposite reaction. Non-violence turns this Newton's law, but in the opposite direction. If violence generates violence, love should generate love. Or if my strong, aggressive, violent act towards others, for every such aggressive violence act, instead of that, if my reaction is gentle, the counter reaction will also be gentle. Vinoba Bhave has said it beautifully, and I was fortunate to be present when he expounded this. Difficult to understand concept, but he said, in the law of violent war, you have to use stronger and stronger weapon, more and more destructive weapons. In the non-violent struggle, it is the opposite. Because every action generates equal and opposite reaction, he didn't utter Newton's, but he's actually using it in a way, when he said that your response should be gentle and gentler and the most gentle, and you will get more and more results, and cycle of violence will be broken. So this is the science of nonviolence. In the science of nonviolence, not only there is no reaction because you become gentle and gentler and more nonviolent, but actually Vinoba beautifully says it. He says in nonviolence, there is no opponent. There is no enemy. Nobody is your enemy. If your heart is full of love and friendship towards others, there is no enemy. And there is no point in pretending it. But if you really have that love for others, even for your so-called opponents or your so-called enemies, then it will generate love. It will not generate reaction. And so, if you are seeking, it's for truth. There is no opponent to truth. If you are using non-violence, there is no enemy for non-violence. Then you use both. You become a non-violent seeker of truth. You become a satyagrahi. One who insists on truth using non-violence. And that's why Gandhi wanted his workers to become satyagrahi scientists. Satyagrahi should become scientist, and the scientist should become satyagrahi. And for satyagrahi, to be satyagrahi and not to be duragrahi or not to be ahankaragrahi, we have to be non-violent. We have to be scientific. Accept the truth. Accept the refutation of your hypothesis. So actually, non-violence is science of mind. Science of reaction of mind. And that's why Gandhi said that truth and non-violence are as ancient as the hills. They are based on nature's laws. He says that I have not invented them. They are not my inventions. They existed in the nature. As violence exists in the nature, similarly, non-violence and love also exist in the nature. Finally, let's come to the last question, last part. How is Gandhi relevant in the 21st century? Relevant to us. 21st century faces three global challenges. The curse of capitalism, that is infinite greed and humongous inequality, economic and political inequality. The curse of consumerism, excessive consumption leading to the climate change, global warming, and the curse of communalism leading to the racial and interfaith violence. These three are the most important global challenges before the humanity. What does Gandhi offer? Now, it is interesting. While these global challenges are external, they are global, Gandhi's solutions to these are internal and they are personal. We usually seek for global problem, we seek global solution. For external problem, we seek external causes and external solution. Gandhi is funny. That's why he's different. That's why he's unique. His solutions are internal and personal. For greed and accumulation, and in today's for-profit world, the capitalistic world, greed has become good. In that one movie, the hero of the Wall Street even says, the greed is good. More greed, more accumulation, more profit. And it leads to economic inequality. We have all seen Oxfam's report. 2% of the people own 98% of world's property and wealth. 9% in India own wealth more than half of the population of India, more than 70 crore people of India, only 9% in India own that much wealth. Humongous inequality. To this, Gandhi's solution is not killing them, but his solution is personal, aparigraha. Aparigraha means non-accumulation, non-possession, possession as little as possible. This tattva comes from Jainism, from Buddhism, and also from Patanjali Yoga, but aparigraha. And for capitalist, his solution is trusteeship. You may have a lot of capital, but use it for social good. And surprisingly, at Gandhi's own time, several leftist people laughed at him. The capitalist is a man-eater tiger. He would never become trustee, but now we see Bill Gates and Warren Buffett and Azim Premji and Tata's and so many are giving away their wealth for social purpose. Because after a particular limit, what can you do with the wealth? It doesn't give any joy, any pleasure. So Gandhi's solutions are personal, internal. For consumerism, which leads to fossil fuel use, excessive consumption and global warming, which will destroy the earth and the all living animals and plants and human beings. His solution is again body labor, sharir shram. He considers it as sacred, almost like a religious activity. You must do body labor every day. You must earn your bread through body labor. That's called bread labor. He makes vratas out of this. If you do body labor, you will not become parasite on the others. You will not consume excessively, and you will not consume nature's resources too much. For our enormous, infinite desire for pleasures, he says, aswad, disinterest in the pleasures of titillation. All personal solutions, all solutions which you and me probably can try. For communal hatred, his solution is not really bomb against the bomb, or gun against the gun, or Murdabad against Zindabad. His solution is love and non-violence. Problems are global, problems are external, and Gandhi's solutions are internal and personal. And it begins with yourself. Several years ago, I had gone for a conference in London. Conference was of little high class people, and so we all delegates were taken first to Queen's Palace and then to the Parliament and to the House of Lords, and there was reception for us. I was uncomfortable. This is not my usual world. So when we came out of the British Parliament, right in front of the Parliament, three groups of different people were protesting. So I felt, oh, these people seem to be activists like me. So I left this delegation and went to those. There were three different groups. One was protesting against the global warming and appealing to the British government to sign Kyoto Protocol. Another was saying this was a pacifist group which was appealing to the government to bring back soldiers from the Iraq. And the third one was asking for higher wages and working conditions for the labor. Three different political groups protesting against the British Parliament. Behind them was a huge common banner uniting them. And that banner was, be the change yourself that you wish to see in the world, Mahatma Gandhi. I felt that even 50 years after his death, at that time, old man was still standing in front of the British Parliament and challenging the British authority and the global authority with his appeal, with his slogan, be the change that you wish to see in the world. You don't have to run after the world. You don't have to go and fight wars everywhere. Change can begin with yourself. Friends, to summarize, impression that Gandhi was anti-science is unfounded. This is our first finding. Second finding is that Gandhi was an ardent follower and keen user of scientific knowledge and methods, especially the experimentation. Third, he added the test of morality to the methods of material sciences, be it the vivisection or methods of mass production or mass destruction. But everything was tested on the test of morality. Gandhi's unique strength and his greatness are located not in using science, that is commonplace. His greatness was in his moral methods. That is what Gandhi was special for. His two major principles, non-violence, appears to be consistent with Newton's third law of mechanics. applied to human psychology and behavior. It's a deep psychology, but it's Newton's law. Finally, Gandhi used a very sensitive and refined but subjective method of the voice of conscience to test the moral truth. To the global challenges, to the three global challenges of the 21st century, Gandhi offers internal, personal, and moral solutions. That's what we, in this exploration, that's what we find. To return to the original dilemma of Time magazine, Time magazine selected Albert Einstein as the person of the 20th century, but Albert Einstein has already answered the question when he said, generations to come will scarce believe that such a one in flesh and blood ever walked on this earth. This is an ultimate compliment to Mahatma Gandhi after his death. This is an enormous compliment. The tallest scientist ever, Albert Einstein, is saluting the tallest man of his time in these words. Time magazine was right. If Albert Einstein was the person of the 20th century, then I would say that Mahatma Gandhi will be the person of the 21st century. Thank you very much.